Miriam Meets on RTE Radio 1 with Miriam O'Callaghan.
My guests this morning are celebrating their wedding anniversary this weekend. They've been a couple for nearly 30 years and they're married 16. They have three adult children and live in rural County Tyrone. Writer and comedian Kevin McAleer first came to national notice on RT Television's legendary Nighthawks programme 25 years ago. He continues to enjoy a very successful comedy career and will appear at this year's Cat Laughs Comedy Festival. And on Monday nights at the moment on RT Television, he's presenting a programme called Our Friends in the North about the Ulster Scots language, landscape and community. His wife is Valerie Whitworth. She is a painter whose passion is choral singing, and she sings and teaches the Together One voice choir in Oma, near where they both now live. You're both very welcome.
Thank you.
Congratulations on your wedding anniversary.
Another one.
10 o'clock roughly at this moment we're talking. Can you remember what you were doing on the day of your wedding?
Well, I was doing the classic thing of just getting dressed and getting ready and getting the kids ready, because our kids were 5 and 6 at the time, and my mother was there and a friend, and Kevin was elsewhere, so we were playing at being single for the night.
But what did you wear?
I wore a dress that I found in Camden Market for 30 quid, and which I thought was very lovely. It's sort of like a lacy, flowery dress. It was lovely.
Colour?
Cream with a bit of sort of hawthorny type colours of brown and green. He didn't notice it at all.
Yes, he did, Kevin. Tell me you noticed her wedding dress.
Not at the time, no. I was too busy looking at her face.
Where did you get married, first of all, Kevin?
Marylebone Registry office, yeah, in London.
Very famous, that registry office.
Baker Street. Yeah. But it was Marylebone.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And did you enjoy it?
It was wonderful. It was magical. Yeah. Yeah. And we did do the thing of, you know, I went and stayed somewhere the night before and met up on the day. So I was busy, yeah, getting ready. My best man was organising me and making sure I had, my tie tied properly.
What did you wear, come to think of it, Kevin? I mustn't be sexist about these questions. What did you wear?
I wore a suit, which is very rare for me. How would you describe the colour?
Pale green.
Pale green?
There's no green in it at all. It's kind of a fawn, grey fawn colour. You're thinking of somebody else.
Quite flash then, your suit, was it?
Yeah, I mean, and it was silk, or was it? It was a very fine, delicate material anyway, and it's hanging up in the wardrobe, very carefully preserved.
Why did you decide to get married, I suppose, after you'd lived together for so long?
The thing of getting married had come up at various times, and it just wasn't the right time. No, don't really need to do that, or don't want to do that, or whatever. And then all of a sudden, at the same point, actually, it was the same weekend, we both... Individually, Kevin was away in Ireland and I was in London, and he came back, and it was actually it was a leap year, and we actually came to propose to each other at the same time, which was really lovely.
Really? Yeah. Tell me about that.
But vague memories of it.
No. Typical man.
We did come to, it was just one of those nice pieces of magical, you know, synchronicity that we both hit on the idea, more or less at the same time. We had three kids within a year.
Because you're twins as well, haven't you? Yeah.
Yeah, we had a girl, and then
Florence.
Practically, a year later, we had our twin boys, Louis and Josiah. A lot of work. And by the time they were 6 or 7, we had survived that, you know, and they were up and running. And it was a celebration of surviving the whole thing.
Who asked first that weekend then? Can you remember?
Well, because it was the leap year, he'd just come back from working in Ireland, and because it was the 29th of February, I just thought, oh, well, yes, okay.
Good woman. Where did you originally meet, Kevin?
We met, was it a party in your flat? Mm. No.
No, I love men and women, it's Venus, Mars.
We met in her flat.
Okay, keep checking with her, go on.
And we had mutual friend connections, I suppose. But I suppose it wasn't, it wasn't like our eyes met across a crowded room. It was a very slow-burning thing. And Valerie was an art student, and I loved her paintings. And I was doing my comedy slideshow. And I think it's fair to say that you liked my slideshow. So it was like an artistic meeting of minds.
And from your memory, can you remember meeting him?
His friend had said, you should meet my friend, he's a comedian. And I don't like comedians, I don't get jokes. But when we became friends, and then I remember going round to see Kevin, and he was preparing for his slideshow, and the slide images were so totally different from, I just thought, wow, he is a genius. And yes, I think I fell in love.
What about his accent?
No, it wasn't his accent.
In spite of my accent. Yeah. I suppose I'd lost most of the corners of my accent anyway. Like, my sisters at that point would have accused me of having a Dublin accent, because when I went to Dublin after I left school, I had to lose the corners of my accent very quickly because, nobody could understand a word I was saying, basically. So I've got a very watered down.
Really?
Tyrone accent.
It's a lovely accent.
Thank you.
Listen, we're going to take the first piece of music on you, which is the Staples. Tell me why you both like this.
We made a sort of a tape. Actually, it was cassette still. In those days, in 1997, we made a cassette tape for our wedding of music that we had in common. We disagreed over certain tracks on that, but, one that we both loved was the Staple Singers, I'll Take You There. It's a gospel song, and it's a gospel spiritual song, and the lyric, I suppose, means I'll take you to heaven, But for us, it was I'll take you to that special, magical place, where our relationship dwells when it's working properly.
Staple thing is there, I'll Take You There, a piece of music you both love, reminds you of your wedding. Listen, you moved back to Drumnakilly in County Tyrone, near where you grew up, actually, Kevin, didn't you? Both of you in 97. First of all, why did you move back?
Well, we were living in London, and we're living in a two-bedroom council flat with three small children, and we didn't even have a garden. We were going up and down two sets of stairs with two buggies, a double buggy and a single buggy. My father had died in 1995, and so the house was just, lying there empty for a few years. And I had no idea of moving back at all, neither of us would have had. And I just kind of came out of the blue that just casually said we could live in the house, and we kind of exchanged glances. And before we knew it, it had grown into an idea, and from an idea to something really exciting, It all happened quite suddenly and kind of out of the blue, and it was just a fantastic move. And I think I could speak for all of us when they say we've never regretted it for a minute.
And was it a big shock for you to go from London to live in Drumnakilly?
I think it was just the right time. So actually, I think I had grown up in a small town in England, and always on the edge of town. And then when I was 19, my mother had moved out to rural Suffolk and the real edge of Suffolk, which is not dissimilar. So I think, there was a familiarity, to being there. So I think that had I not had that experience and I'd just come straight from London, then it would have been a total shock.
Describe Drumnakilly for people who don't know it, Kevin.
It's a townland and it's very rural, narrow country roads. And when I grew up there, I was born there in 1956, and we didn't have electricity until 1968, And my dad didn't drive. My dad learned to drive when he was someone like 60. So it was a very, very sheltered upbringing, Obviously no television, because we didn't have electricity. The oil lamps and listening to the radio. And there was one house in the townland that the guy had his own generator. He was very technically advanced. And we would go over there to watch really important events like the All-Ireland Final or the funeral of JFK in 1963, which is the first thing I ever saw on television.
What did your dad work on?
He was a farmer, small farmer. In the 60s, a lot of the small farmers went off to work on the M1 motorway. They built the M1 from Belfast down to Dungannon. So a lot of the local farmers went to work on that, and that was like a gold rush to them, you know, to be coming home with on a Friday evening with regular money in their pocket. You know, I remember that was a very important social social development, say in the mid-60s or something like that.
And what was your mum like?
I think she was a very quiet housewife, you know. Well, obviously, you know, she did all the work on the farm as well. She never went too far, you know. My dad would have gone out, Kaelian as we called it, you know, he would have gone out visiting the neighbours' houses in the evenings, and I think he was the last of that generation who did that sort of thing. But she would have mostly stayed at home, and I think she was a very witty woman in a quiet way. She would come out with these devastating quips now and again, and she would mimic people, you know. So I think I got, you know, at least half of my
whiff from my her.
Yeah, my one-liners from her.
Happy childhood?
No. I feel my life didn't really get off the ground until I was 18, when I left the north and went to Dublin to come to college, you know. Suddenly I discovered alcohol and conversation and things like that, because, you know, the north was a very closed place, you know, that thing of, you know, whatever you say, say nothing, permeated the whole social landscape, I think. And obviously the Troubles came along at the end of the 60s as well, and it made that even worse, you know. So I don't think I was aware of how repressed the whole setup was until I left, and I felt a huge release, you know, when I went to Dublin. And as you say, it seemed very colourful and very lively, and people just gabbling non-stop about nothing. I was fascinated, by the way. People could talk for hours about nothing. I loved it.
But did you worry taking your young children back to a place where you hadn't been particularly happy?
I didn't, because, like, as Valerie says, it happened very naturally. You know, it was something that the timing was just perfect, you know, and it was like the decision made itself. The timing was so good that the decision made itself. And I didn't worry at all. I felt there had been a sea change as well, as Seamus Heaney put it in the political atmosphere. So I wouldn't have dreamed of taking my children into the atmosphere of the 70s that I grew up on. But I didn't feel that was a risk. And even when the bomb happened, you know, the year afterwards, I still didn't feel that it was the wrong thing to do, because that was just such an insanely senseless act against the whole current and desire people had for a new way of life, you know. So even that didn't shake her faith, you know.
What about you, Valerie? When that horrendous Omagh bomb went off the following year, you just moved back, you know, you're an English woman living there. Did it make you doubt at all your decision to go there?
No, which is surprising. And I mean, we were just very lucky, because we had planned to do what everyone else was doing, going and shopping for school uniforms, that kind of thing. And just on that morning, Kevin said, oh, let's go and visit friends. So we did. But it didn't. I never wanted to stay in London forever. So when, you know, the idea had come to go to Ireland, because Kevin's from there, and because the children's grandfather was from there, there felt like a real connection and there a real reason to be there. It wasn't like we were just going somewhere just for any old idea, just to see, because we liked the look of the place. It was, there was a real connection there, so I really liked that.
Which makes it very real. Do you find it a very different place now than the place you grew up in?
I suppose there's so much that's the same, you know. Most of the neighbours are still the same, and that was a very...
Is the generator really, still there with the guy?
No, we've all got electricity now, all mod cons. But it was very reassuring to have that, you know, familiar thing of knowing who all the neighbours were and knowing they were all really sound people, you know. So you didn't have that thing of being in an isolated spot in a rural community and wondering, you know, what was out there in the dark ever. You knew that you were surrounded by friendly, sound people. So that was, you know, that was really reassuring.
And for your work as a painter, did you find the landscape even, or the environment of Tyrone helped your work?
Well, I suppose at that time, the kids were 6 and 7, and I was just getting back to being creative after being completely snowed under with them. And it happened that there was a community arts training course the following year. So I did that as just a way of picking up my creative threads again. And so I got involved with community arts then, and I really didn't look back. We formed a little group out of that and then got a Millennium Carnival going in the town the following year. And so that really opened up a whole network of friends and really sort of got me sort of embedded into the community in a way which I think wouldn't have happened otherwise. And it was wonderful. I feel I've had great support from people there, and lots of my sort of creative dreams have sort of come true.
Which is great. You know,
which is, yeah.
John McKelly's the place, obviously.
Yeah, artistic capital of the world. Really.
Yeah, well, it totally released it here. But it brings us to our next piece of music, because you're also involved in the local choir in Oma. And then Thomas Tallis. Tell us about that.
Well, I heard this piece of music, well, it's probably about 6 years ago now, just on the radio, and instantly just was completely bowled over by it. And I did have my community choir at the time, and I just thought, oh, I'd love to be able to sing that myself and also have a chance for them to sing it. But that seemed like a really, really way off dream, because I'm not a trained musician or a classically trained singer. And it looks as though we are going to have that opportunity to do it later in Oma this year. So, again, it's another dream coming true for me, and it's amazing.
Great. Let's listen to it now. Beautiful Thomas Tallis piece there. When did you first get interested in choirs, by the way, Valerie?
I went to and had a shiatsu treatment when I was children about 3 years old. Someone treated it to me, and the woman there said, oh, you should go singing. Singing's great for depression. And I hadn't even realised I was depressed. She said, there's a class on a Friday morning and it's got a creche, and go to it. And I just thought, wow, someone's telling me to go and do something that I've always loved, but just didn't think there was any opportunities or couldn't see how that there was any spaces for people to sing. So I went, and I really didn't look back after that. And I just knew that when I moved over here that I had to bring singing with me. And because there was no one else here or in Northern Ireland where we lived doing it, I had to sort of just lead by default. So it started off with me and my kids, and it was a children and adult choir to start off with.
It's really interesting, though. I think there is probably a lot of women, maybe old parents, men and women, but women who may be very young kids, that sometimes do end up in a place, whether you call it depression or not, just through the sheer exhaustion. Mm. And did you find that?
I think there's a combination of factors. Mm. And I think that obviously at different times in your life, there's these openings for looking at what's gone on before. So I think it was just one of those crisis points where lots of things came together and those crises then are opportunities to heal.
And how was Kevin during this time?
Yeah, that's a big question. I suppose the years when the kids were very small were difficult times, you know. Mm-hmm. I suppose our whole relationship has been a roller coaster, really. Our relationship is something that we kind of observe from happening to us. It's almost like watching a movie or something, and it seems to have a life of its own, and sometimes we're very puzzled by it, and sometimes we're stand back and admire it, you know. But those early years when the kids were very young were you know, rocky times for all of us.
But I think as well, and it was a thing that I'd forgotten about earlier, was that it coincided with Kevin becoming famous over here, so there was a lot to contend
with. He's smiling, but yeah,
and so he would be leaving, traveling to Dublin, and a very sudden sort of big wave of fame over here, and playing to packed houses, and then coming back into a small flat with three crazy babies, you know, kind of so very extreme time. So it was an extreme time for all of us.
But it's a tribute to the strength of your relationship that you survived all of that.
It is.
So what did sustain you as a couple?
I think there's something magical about our relationship. And as I say, it's got a life of its own. And even when at times when we weren't getting on and we'd be arguing a lot, before we had children, we were puzzled about why we were bothering, you know, because You think, why are we suffering like this, you know, when we could be out there enjoying ourselves? But there was someone about the relationship that said, hang on, you know, and we just followed where it took us, and, you know, it's taken us to magical places.
Are you romantic?
Yeah. Well, this is a very good line to use, but I don't go in for Valentine's Day because my line is, every day is Valentine's Day.
Yeah. Why are you laughing at that?
Yeah, good question.
Maybe she's not convinced. Is he good about talking about his emotions?
Yes.
Is he? That's interesting.
Yeah. I think that it's tribute to Kevin that he...
Don't tell her anything.
Ignore him, okay? Just look at me.
Is able to change.
Yeah, that's true. Like, I was a very narky, kind of a moody individual when I was younger. And, you know, having the three small kids didn't help that. But at some point along the way, I don't know what happened, but I changed, you know. I just became happier. And, you know, I'd have arguments where I would sulk and wasted an awful lot of time in arguments and moods that were completely unnecessary. And somehow I managed to switch out of it, and I'm much happier.
That's great, though, that you did switch out of it. Mm. How'd you do that?
I don't know.
I think you did read a book on anger management, or read stuff on anger management, and it really helped.
It's not just us women who read the self-help books.
It's a crisis point, you know. Yeah. You get to the point where, you know, it's that or not. So.
Well, I'm annoyed that you brought that up.
Because it might help some other people.
Because there's something very laid back about you, though, Kevin. He comes across as very laid back, doesn't he?
People say about it must be great crack living with a comedian, yeah. You know, and, you know, she leaves a long pause before she answers.
A lot of comedians, I suppose, are, it's a cliche, but you can be quite dark people to live with.
You know, like, I don't suffer from depression or anything like that, but I was a very short-tempered, moody person who you know, wasted a lot of time in moods and arguments that were all my fault and a huge waste of time. And luckily, I managed to change that, you know. Not half soon enough, but better late than never.
And luckily for you, Valerie loves you very much and stuck you.
Exactly.
Stuck with you.
Yeah, she was very patient.
But I'd say he's funny a lot of the time too, though, is he?
Yeah, he still makes me laugh and is definitely the funniest comedian that I know, and I still think he's a genius.
You tell that story. I love that story because I'm going to take a piece of music from Van. I was reading your Sunday Miscellany, the one about you travelling all over the world. Tell me that story.
Yeah, well, my father didn't travel anywhere, you know, like he stayed at home. And I remember trying to get him to go to London once to see me. And he said, what would I see in London that I wouldn't see here?
I love your father. We're back to drum the kidding.
I couldn't think of an answer to that. And then, I was travelling around the world a lot, and the neighbours would say to him, where's Kevin now? And he said, I don't know where he is. And there was no internet or email or mobiles in those days. And then I would come back and I would tell him where I was, and then I would say I was in India, and then, you know, I sat by the Ganges for a week, and then I went to San Francisco and they painted houses, and then I went to Amsterdam and I was cleaning toilets in the airport, and then I was picking tulip bulbs, and then I came back to Dublin, and then I got the bus up here. And he said, was there many on the bus? True story.
They're always the best. But then we're going to take a piece of music from Van Morrison. Mm. Why do you like this song?
Just reminds me of the time just after our daughter Florence was born, and a friend, Eta Kelly, sent us the album Poetic Champions, which I love the whole album, but this just reminds me of that very special time when you have a new baby, and it was just very peaceful, and it just reminds me both of our lovely daughter Florence and also, of course, my lovely husband Kevin.
I've been searching a long time, someone exactly like you. I've been traveling all around the world, waiting for you to come through. Someone like you make it all worthwhile. Someone like you keep me satisfied. Someone exactly like you.
The wonderful Van Morrison there, Someone Like You. You both love it. How did you become a comedian, by the way?
Well, I drifted into it in my mid-20s, you know. It wasn't something that I was always wanted to do or anything like that. And I was in San Francisco at the time, and I was about 25, and there was a comedy club, and that was my first experience of a comedy club, of the new wave of comedy, I suppose. And there was an audience spot where you could get up from the audience, and there was a big gong by the side of the stage, and you tried your hand out, and when the audience had enough of you, they shouted, "Gong." And someone in me told me to get up and do this. And I didn't manage to pluck up the courage to do it in San Francisco. I went a few weeks and it was on the edge of my seat, you know, after four or five drinks, and just didn't manage to do it. And on the plane home, I was kicking myself. But when I landed in Dublin, I was living in Dublin then when I came home, and there was a comedy club had just started up of the same format, and went along to it, and there was the same audience spot.
Was that the Hollywood Hotel?
The Hollywood Hotel, yeah.
Read about it, yeah.
So it was placed in front of me again, you know. And this time I did manage to make the leap from the chasm between the audience and the stage. I managed to cross it and grab the microphone and, you know, said a few words, got a laugh or two, and was just completely hooked and completely excited by it.
Is it not terrifying, though, to do stand-up?
It was then, but it was a mixture of sheer excitement and terror, you know. Like, I was so excited that I went home and, you know, could barely sleep until the next week. It was a once a week thing, and I was writing away, you know, and I came back, I think it was 15 minutes of material the next week. But it was terrifying as well, and I used to wish when I was going on that something would happen, you know, it would be a power cut or anything to save me from the precipice. And I used to think, if I get through this, it was like being in a plane where you're told two of the engines are gone, and you think, if I get down, I'm going to take the boat from now on. It was that sort of feeling, you know. But then you would get the laugh again, and you would get over that. And
it's like a drug.
Yeah. But I'm not terrified anymore, you know, like the terror has worn off now. It's just nerves now.
But the nerves remain, I assume.
Yeah, they do. And, you know, if you weren't nervous, you'd be bored, you know. So I think you need the nerves. You need the nerves to get that edge of energy, you know. So,
and now when he's going on or preparing for a show, do you notice he gets a bit tense or not?
No, but there's certain times that he has to just focus in on what he's doing. But no, I think he handles it incredibly well, and I know now, but most other people wouldn't know.
Do you ever try out any of your routines on Valerie?
No. I don't try them out on anybody, or, you know, not even myself, you know.
Not even in the bathroom mirror.
No, it's just something you have to do with an audience, you know, to know if it's going to work or not.
Your granny jokes always work, didn't they?
Well, my you know, my Nighthawks character used to I used to give the impression that he didn't know what he was going to say next, you know, and yeah. Now I've grown into the persona because I'm racking my brains about what that persona used to say. I suppose he talked about Granny sitting around the television. My grandmother, yeah, we would sit around the television, the whole 17 of us in a circle, half of us looking at the back of it, and my grandmother would say, "What's on the other side?" And we would watch it all night, 24 hours a day. And then it was good. You know, we would watch it, the whole lot of it. And then my grandmother would say, "Turn it on." And we would turn on the television. And that was good as well. It's coming back. It's coming back to me.
When you were younger, did you ever make jokes about the troubles? A lot of people draw on their background for their material, but did you at first avoid that?
I did, not consciously, but I just wanted to talk about, I suppose I just wanted to escape from it all, and I wanted to talk about silly things, you know, and silly universal topics. But strangely, in the mid-90s, when the mood was changing and the ceasefires were around, I suppose maybe I felt safe to put my head above the parapet, but suddenly I wanted to talk about the North, you know, once it had all died down. And I went through a couple of years of talking about it in my shows. I don't think it did me any favours in terms of my my audience numbers, you know. I think I think a lot of people lost interest at that point, because I think, you know, a lot of people in the South don't want to know. And I don't say that as an accusation, you know.
No, it's true.
I just say it as a fact. And a lot of people who were very tickled by my Nighthawk stuff sort of lost interest when I did my political years. I'm now back to talking universal nonsense again.
Grannies, etc.
That was something I had to get out of my system, but I think I lost a lot of audience numbers along the way.
Do you think it's a much different place to live in now?
Oh, definitely. You know, as I said, there was that sea change. That was exciting, and I could feel that energy, that change, even though I was living in London and I wasn't home much, you know, but I just felt it in the air, that the energy had changed dramatically for the better, you know, and despite, you know, some very negative undercurrents, the general mood is still very positive and very energetic.
In terms of your children now, you've two sons and a daughter. Do they regard themselves Irish, English, Northern Irish, Ulster Scots?
they become Irish. And yes, I was quite horrified at the start of that because they had grown up and they'd started off in England, and I saw them very much as half and half, and I, even when we moved here, I thought that's what they would continue to do. So, but then when they were sort of mid-teenagers, all of a sudden became Irish, and I was really quite put out about it. But I have learned to accept it now, and now they've gone to college and in England, which I was, oh, that's nice, you know, kind of like get some of your English
DNA
back in there. But when they're in England, they're identified as being Irish as well. So, you know, kind of like I have to, you know, I just accept that now.
Do you remain connected to England, though? I mean, do you still very much regard yourself as English?
Yeah, well, I guess I probably would read The Guardian. And yes, I have Radio 4 on. I don't watch TV, really. So, but yeah, so I guess it's just good to have that, to keep that thread, because I've been living here such a long time, I have actually started to feel slightly like a stranger in my own home. So it's very important to keep connected, you know.
But you go back as well to recharge your singing batteries in England as well, don't you? You
know, singing and and spiritual.
Yeah, you go back, do you?
Yeah.
But identity is fascinating, because that program you've been making about Ulster Scots. Tell us about Ulster Scots.
Well, I was approached by RTE and Tern Television, who made the programme, and asked would I be interested in presenting this programme about the Ulster Scots culture. And I just loved the idea, because I was brought up in a Catholic background, you know. I'm not a Catholic anymore, but culturally I suppose I'd always be a mid-Ulster Catholic. So I just loved the idea of having a sort of a passport to cross those lines, those culture lines, which are still so rigidly drawn, you know, in the North. So it was a chance for me to just cross those lines and go to places and talk to people that I wouldn't have had a chance of doing otherwise, you know. And I was around a lot of corners that I'd never been in before, like Raffo Orange Hall or Drum Village down in County Cavan, which is a very Presbyterian little village, which was caught on the wrong side of the border, you know, from their point of view, when partition was drawn. It's very interesting to see that other perspective of a community that's hurt and still really coming to terms with being caught on the wrong side and being left high and dry. These are their terms, you know, but it's interesting to see that from the other side.
It's probably a side you'd never have even thought of growing up.
No, and just to be given that opportunity to go to those places, just priceless. Like, there's a little Ulster Scots cultural group who meet about 5 miles from where I live, and it was the programme researchers who told me about it, you know, and that shows the divide, you know, that was the roundabout way that I had to take to step into this little hall 5 miles away.
Yeah.
Was this little scene going on that I didn't know about?
Has that inspired you to go back the whole programme and learn Irish?
It has, yeah, in a very roundabout way. Like, I loved the poets that I came across. You know, there's a poet called James Fenton. I couldn't believe how good he was. And he writes in Ulster Scots, so by definition it's a it's a minority scene that he's in.
Yeah.
The just the eloquence of the language, and not just him, but the other poets, you know, going back, you know, poets who were around in 1798 who were writing about the rising. And there was real just a pride and an eloquence in the way that they were doing their stuff. And I had kind of echoes of that in Irish myself, you know, like I learned Irish in the 70s in school. And I just thought, I'm going to explore this, you know, and I've taken it upon myself to learn Irish properly.
Good for you.
So it's a very roundabout way to come about learning Irish.
And how's your Irish at the moment?
Well, it's improving. I'm doing a class once a week, and I'm going to do my show in Irish in the Catlass Festival in Kilkenny in early June. I've just had that translated, and I'm...
By Gabriel Rosenstock, isn't
yeah.
it? Yeah.
So I was, you know, delighted to get someone of that
yeah, he's brilliant. We've spoken to him here.
To translate my...
But would you be nervous getting up and speaking Oscar Elga?
I don't think so. I mean, it's a big challenge to learn it, because, you know, my Irish is a long way to go, you know. So there'll be a lot of homework involved in actually learning the thing, you know. But I don't think I'd be any more nervous than... I would in English, because in a way it gives you an excuse to fail, yeah. you know, like it's a kind of it's a
but will people understand the punchlines?
I don't know if they'd understand any of it, never mind the punchlines. I mean, it's hard enough to understand it in English at times, you know, there's a high element of nonsense in it in any language. But, you know, I've done enough shows in English where the audience looks blankly at you with their mouths open. So it couldn't be any worse than those.
Of course, Valerie, you possibly and probably don't know a word of Irish, do you?
No, that too, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But I do know that show, so I still think I would go and watch it just to sort of, to hear it. Well, I'm getting to like the sound of the Irish language.
Did you think, as a child growing up in Ipswich, that your life would be married to a Drumnacrilly comedian with three kids living in rural County Tyrone?
No, never did. You never know where life's going to take you, do you?
Yeah, but certainly been a very interesting route.
Yeah.
Kevin said earlier he's not Catholic anymore. Do you have any religion, spirituality?
I consider myself a regular spiritual person. And I think my father was that. He always would have said grace and been on a bit of a... spiritual journey himself, but I don't belong to any church. And I
did you bring
like
your children up with anything?
No,
they heard about God in school. I remember Louis coming home and saying, do you believe in God, Dad? And I said, no, I don't. And he said, even though he's everywhere,
he's gonna go far that son of yours.
I just think sort of like we have a more, you know, just a more a nature-centered sort of spirituality, really.
No vestiges of your Tyrone Catholicism remain?
Not at all, but, I would regard myself as a very spiritual person as well. And I would like to think I live by a moral code, but it's a natural human being sense of right and wrong, you know. Very little Catholic traces remain, I think.
Do you think you'd be going to a special place for comedians in heaven?
No, I'd be deeply disturbed by the notion that there might be an afterlife, you know.
Why? Most people really want there to be one.
No, I'm placing all my bets on going out like a light, you know. I want to go to where my dog is gone. Yeah. And anything else, I'd be deeply worried about.
And you, Valerie?
I'm kind of veered towards some form of reincarnation, I guess, because that spark of spirit must go somewhere. And I
that's fascinating. So what would you like to come back
as? Oh, what I'd like to.
As Kevin? No.
We'll swap psyches.
But look, we're going to go out on a song you love, Kevin, Growing Your Duffy. I'd rather go blind. Tell me about this.
I was driving home from a show late at night, with the other end of the country, Cork or somewhere far away, and this voice came on the radio. I just thought it was a fantastic voice, a blues song, I'd Rather Go Blind, and it was a very natural voice, you know. I like voices that are personal and individual, and she was singing the blues song, but she was singing it in her own style, and she was saying yes instead of yeah. I think that's what made it for me. I thought, who is that voice? And then there was a guitar, and I said, wow, what's that guitar? And then I listened at the end of the song and said I was Granny Duffy. So I kept her name in my head until I got home, Googled her, and she was Granny Duffy. And she also plays the guitar. And I think it's just a fantastic voice and a fantastic guitar sound.
Brilliant. I'm looking forward to listening to it now. Our Friends in the North, that series you've made in Ulster Scots, continues for the next 3 weeks on Monday evenings at 7:30 on RT1 television. Best of luck, Valerie, with all your singing, choirs and painting. Best of luck, Kevin, Oscar Elga at Cat's Laugh. Might go down just to see it. And my thanks on sound today to Dave Gibson, to my producer, Eileen Herron. Happy anniversary to you both, by the way. Hope you've got another 50 years together.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much for listening. We'll be here at the same time next Sunday, and we're going out listening to Grania Duffy with I'd Rather Go Blind.
Something told me it was over. When I saw you and that girl talking.
Miriam meets on RTE Radio 1 with Miriam O'Callaghan.